everybody. I'm really glad you're here tonight. Appreciate you.
Through sunshine and rain,
see.
How many of those tonight that the God we're serving is above everything? Amen. Tonight. because he could have thought of anybody, but he thought of me. He thought of you. I appreciate him tonight. Tony, come back to the piano. Sister Terry, come up here and sing Consider the Lilies, will you? I want to keep this flow tonight.
Thank you.
through chain breaking before I preached tonight. Is that all right? I don't care what you came in here with. You can leave different than what you came in with. If the enemy can keep you bound, he's won that victory. We ought to realize God comes along just to set us free. Amen.
Thank you.
for that. Has he ever broke any chains for you? Pentecostal for just a little while tonight. I've been preaching real hard to our church and to myself, and I came home from taking these youth to play basketball, and I've never sweated so much in my life. And I sat down, I showered and sat down on my couch, and I felt like the Lord spoke to me about this scripture. And I want to preach from 2 Kings chapter 2, and I will not hold you too long to that. Verse number 8. And Elijah took his mantle and wrapped it together and smote the waters, and they were divided hither and thither. So that the two went over on dry ground. He's talking about the Jordan River. It came to pass when they were going over that Elijah said unto Elisha, ask what I shall do for thee before I be taken away from thee. And Elisha said, I pray thee that a double portion of thy spirit be upon me. And he said, thou hast asked a hard thing. Nevertheless, if thou see me when I am taken from thee, it shall be so unto thee. But if not, it shall not be so. And it came to pass as they went on and talked, that behold, there appeared a chariot of fire, and horsemen of fire, and parted them both asunder. And Elijah went up by a whirlwind into heaven. And Elisha saw it. Praise the Lord for vision. And Elisha saw it and cried, my father, the chariot of Israel and the horsemen thereof. And he saw him no more, and took hold of his own clothes and rent them in two pieces. And he took up also the mantle of Elijah that fell from him, and went back and stood by the bank of Jordan. He took the mantle of Elijah that fell from him and smote the waters and said, where is the Lord God of Elijah? And when he had smitten the waters, they parted hither and thither, and Elisha went over. I want to stop reading right there, and I want to focus in for just a few moments upon the scripture here that talks about Elijah. Elisha asked the question, where is the Lord God of Elijah? I want to lay a foundation, if I can, for just a moment. I won't preach maybe 15, 20 minutes to you, hopefully. This scripture intrigues me, and in fact, out of all the characters of the Bible, I'm more intrigued by Elijah and Elisha probably than anybody of the Old Testament. Simply because Elijah is no doubt a man of God. I've got just a few days to go. August the 5th, my mentor, Brother Frank Cannon, will be turning 80 years of age. And I was thinking about him today at 80 years of age. There's not going to be long before he's asked me when he passes away for me to do his funeral. And how many of y'all know that great men of God always have a mantle? They always have the anointing to pass down to the next generation. And Elijah intrigues me because if you study the Bible, you find out that Elijah done seven miracles, a total of seven miracles. He is a man of God. He is a man that comes out of the wilderness. We don't find much about him. It simply says Elisha the Tishbite. He comes by out of the wilderness, and he is wearing camel's hair, and he's eating wild locusts. He is a typology of a coming John the Baptist in the New Testament. And Elijah has the Spirit of God about him. And the Bible says that he begins to do these miracles one after another. He does strange miracles. In fact, he's a strange man. His hair is long. His clothing is camel's hair. He's eating wild locusts and honey. And he comes out thundering a voice of God. He gives words as a great prophet would give words when he says to Ahab, that king, as God has said unto me, and as the word of Elijah is, it shall not rain for 3 years upon the earth. And God brings that to pass, and there's a drought in the land. The drought brings a famine. You see Elijah step into seven miracles. But somewhere along the way, the Bible said there's a young man by the name of Elisha. He's out in the field plowing with his father's oxen. He's digging in the dirt, and the Bible said he watches this man of God, Elijah, come along with a mantle in his hand. He's got it draped over his shoulder. And the Bible said Elijah doesn't preach to him. He doesn't give him a word. He simply passes by the field that Elisha is in. It is something about that man of God that makes Elisha leave what he's doing. He burns the plow. He kills the oxen of his father. He sacrifices them, and then he takes a journey. He's following after them
something to say about enduring and tarrying a little while. See, what made Elisha leave the plow and follow after Elijah was he sensed something on Elijah that he had to have. I wonder tonight where in our church is those men of God and women of God that these young people would get behind and say, I've got to have what they got. Come on, somebody. I don't have to sing like them. I don't have to preach like Terry Simmons. I want to know there's an anointing on their life, and it's the anointing I'm going to crave. Can I tell you, Matthew chapter 5 said, he that hungers and thirsts after righteousness shall be filled. Where's the real men of God and the real women of God that have such an anointing that makes men crave for that anointing?
Amen.
Elisha sees Elijah passing by carrying the mantle, and the Bible said that Elisha sits out after him. He does nothing. He don't preach to him. He don't give him a word of prophecy. He don't give him a word of wisdom, a word of knowledge. He doesn't speak in tongues to him. He just senses the anointing on Elijah. He follows him, and the Bible said, as he's following him, Elijah turns around. Come here, Elisha. Get up and help me for just a moment. Elijah, that old man of God, turns around and notices this young man following him. And if you read the Bible, he turns around and he says, you stay here. I've got to go to the place called Bethel. Bethel is, in the Bible, the place of prayer. Bethel is a place of the house of God. I've got to go through a time of prayer. I'm going to preach on how to get the Holy Ghost tonight. Is it all right? See, the first step for you getting the Holy Ghost is for you to find a place to pray. The first step for you to get the Holy Ghost is to get in these altars and become so hungry for a move of God that it's more than anything else you're hungry for. In order for you to get the Holy Ghost, you've got to go to Bethel a little while. You stay where you're at because I'm going to Bethel. But when he turns around, heading to Bethel, he sees Elisha walking with him. He said, I told you to stay. You know what Elisha's response was? Nevertheless, my Lord, where you go is where I'm going. However far you walk is how far I'm going to walk. I'm going to follow you until I get what my heart's desire is. Understand, Elisha don't know what he wants yet. But that man of God goes to Bethel. He goes to the place of prayer. Anybody can go to prayer, but the next step is even harder. He visits Bethel and prays, and then he gets up from the altar, and the Bible said he starts journeying toward Jericho. Jericho is a place of battle. Jericho is when you gotta fight the enemy. Jericho's when you gotta go through some stuff. But if you ever get the Holy Ghost, the battle will be worth it. What you go through, joy of the Lord that he'll put in your heart. You don't want to merge sin out of us. We get an old-fashioned outpour, cascading downpour of the Holy Ghost. It'll change our world.
Woo.
I got to go to Jericho, so you stay at Bethel. And ain't we wanting to hang out around the altar? I'm all right with praying, but I don't want to fight no battle to get what I want from God. But the Bible said Elijah starts toward Jericho, turns around, and Elisha's following him. You sure you want to go to battle? It's going to cost you some stuff. See, battle may be places of injury. Battle is times you come through that you end up hurt. You may not even understand. Friends will hurt you. The devil will use church people to hurt you. Let me preach a little while. The devil will put things in your path to try to disrupt you getting an outpouring of the Holy Ghost on your life. But if you'll get a made and up determined mind, I'd rather have the Holy Ghost. I'd rather have Jesus. It's worth the battle. I may come out with a few scars. I may be scuffed up a little bit, but bring me to Jericho. I'm ready to fight. The weapons are not.
Pretty good.
You ready to go with me? Jericho. He faces Jericho in the place of battle. And they go through it. And he leaves Jericho. Now listen, I'm going to Jordan. This is the third step. And Jordan in the Hebrew means judgment. I've got to go to a place where I judge myself. Oh, you ain't helping me. See, I got to look myself in the mirror of God's word and find out if I'm worthy for the Holy Ghost or not. You ain't helping me right now. I've been through prayer. I prayed through. I carried at the altars. I've asked God for the Holy Ghost. Can I tell you something? You don't have to live your life asking God for something that He already said was a gift. Give it to your children and your children's children and your children's children. It's God's will for you to be baptized in the power of God and for your children to be baptized and for your grandchildren. I'm telling you, it's God's will for the church to walk in the Spirit of God. But I've come through prayer and I've come through the battle, and now I've got to go to Jordan. I've got to judge myself. I've got to examine to see if I'm worthy to have it or not. And so you stay here at Jericho, and I'm going on to Jordan. As he starts toward Jordan, he turns around. There he is again. He won't leave him. Nevertheless, my Lord, wherever you go is where I'm going. He's got a made up and determined mind. I'm going to get what God's told me I can have. I wish somebody helped me right now. See, we've been sitting in these pews too long. Why? I don't even know if we're a Pentecostal church anymore. You ain't helping me. I said, I don't know if we're a Pentecostal church. We acting like the Baptist act. We acting like the Methodist act. Pentecostals are a rare breed. We speak in tongues and we're not ashamed of it. We prophesy and we're not ashamed of it. We lay hands on the sick and not ashamed of it. We anoint the sick with oil, not ashamed of it. We have word of wisdom and word of knowledge and discernment of spirits and faith. We walk in love and the anointed. I wonder if we're Pentecostal, but I can tell you if we examine our own heart and examine our own life, leave everybody else alone. You may be the only one shouting with the Holy Ghost, but let the others do what they want to. You examine your life good enough that you got it if nobody else has got it.
Come on.
Hey, I gotta go to Jordan, so you stay here. But he travels with him. And then he says this to her. Okay, and listen, enough's enough. You've been to Bethel, you've been to Jericho, you've been to Jordan, and I'm old, I'm about to quit. What is it you're wanting? And Elisha tells him, I want a double portion of that anointing that I've seen you walk in. Now, I fought out with Elisha right here, because he could have said, I want 10 times what you got. But he didn't want to be too prideful. So he just said, give me a double portion of that spirit you got. Here's what the man of God said. If you're with me still, and you see me when I leave here, come on, somebody. I'm talking about enduring until the end now. Help me now. He said, if you're with me when you see me leave here, the very thing that's in your heart, the thing that you want the most, is going to come upon you. The Bible said that when Elijah got to Jordan, he took his mantle and he smote the Jordan with it, and they twined both of them together, walked across Jordan on dry land. Now they're on the other side of judgment. And when they get on the other side of judgment, let me share this with you. There is 50 other prophets sitting up on the hillside. Read it in your Bible. They are watching Elijah and Elisha, seeing if what Elisha wants, if he's going to get it. They don't want to get close enough to the man of God to get it. They want to be spectators in the house of God, but not participators. We don't need no more spectators. We need somebody that'll come up under the skirt of the man of God and say, give me everything you got for me. So they got on the other side of Jordan, and 50 men sat up on a hillside watching these two men, when all of a sudden a chariot of fire comes down out of heaven. Lord God, I could take off running right now. He's calls it the chariot of fire and the horsemen of Israel. You know what happened? Angelic beings surrounded that chariot by the thousands and came down, and the Bible said that they were close, but the chariot went between them and blew them apart. Let me preach right here. Aaron, there's coming a day the Holy Ghost will teach you. Lord, help me right now. The chariot went between them and separated them. But when Elisha looked around, the man of God's gone. As the chariot came by, Elijah just stepped on board. I wished I had some help. And a whirlwind began to twist that thing. Took him up to heaven. My God, I wish I could preach it like I know it. Do you hear me? A chariot, a whirlwind took him to heaven. Why? Because in the book of Matthew, he's going to come back to the world. Don't look for him in the last day. I heard the Bible say that those men told Jesus that the Bible said Elijah must first come before the Messiah. Jesus said, he gets on that chariot, he's gone. And here's what happens. In his heart, he doesn't receive what God has for him yet. He sees the chariot of fire, he sees the whirlwind, he feels the effects of it, but there's no anointing yet. And right before Elijah goes into heaven on that chariot, he drops his mantle. I said he drops his mantle. That used to excite Pentecostals. I said he drops his mantle. You know where it fell? It fell on that young man of God. You know what he done when that mantle fell on him? The Bible said he picked that mantle up. He said, where is the God of Elijah? He had to know. My God, he had to make an assurance. He wanted to know. Is this mantle full of that anointing? And if it is, I want it to prove it. I came by to tell you the real Holy Ghost will prove himself every single time. You don't have to question it. I'm telling you the real thing will prove itself throughout the time and generations. He picked up that mantle. He turned around to that Jordan River. He said, where is the God of Elijah? He smote the waters and Jordan parted and he walked back across. When those men, the Bible said, Lord God help me, saw the anointing that was on that young man of God, they ran down off that mountain and fell at his feet and said, you've got that same Holy Ghost, that same anointing that Elijah had. And now we want to listen to you. This is this, a double portion. Elijah done 7 miracles. Elisha done 13. He failed. He was supposed to have a double portion. He should have been 14 miracles, but it wasn't. It was 13. I don't have time to tell you all the miracles he done. The first one was parting Jordan to get back out. Great miracles. But Elisha grows up. Hear me now what I'm about to say. And gets angry at God. You can read me in the Bible. Years ago, I preached the thought, the dying of an angry man, and I used Elisha. He become coarse. God used him in 13 miracles, and he become coarse and angry with God. and died that way. And sad to say, I think that's the condition of most of our churches. We've went through so much battle, we prayed so long with nothing happening. And we act like if God owes it to us. That we've become hardened at our heart. And we're going through the routine of having church without the anointing. Do you hear me?
Come on.
I want to be Pentecostal. To be Pentecostal, I got to be set free myself. Before I can help set free anybody in the congregation. Paul was Pentecostal when he said, I speak in tongues more than you all. I have revelation. I have vision. I have the anointing on my life. Paul was Pentecostal. Where's hers? Elisha grows up and he becomes an angry man. Not what God intended. He's supposed to do the double portion. He dies. Here's one of the saddest scriptures in the Bible. That mantle he had, they bury him with it. He doesn't pass it alone. He doesn't raise somebody else up under him and say, when you see me depart, you can have what I got. They wrap him in it. They bury him in a cave. And he's dead for years. Until Israel one day is fighting the camp of Syria. And a Syrian soldier gets killed. And Brother Tony, they don't have time to bury him. So they throw him in a cave. Woo, Lord, I feel the Holy Ghost right now.
Come on, man.
When his body tumbles down in that cave, it falls to rest upon the bones of Elisha.
Come on.
And those bones, Lord God, are wrapped in that mantle from Elijah. 13 miracles have passed, but not a fulfillment of God's or Elijah's word to that man of God. But when that Syrian soldier's body, dead from the battle, rose down in that cave and lands on top of the body of Elijah, wrapped in that mantle, poof, life pops in there.
Right.
He comes back out of that cave and says, I'm ready for the battlefield again. God raised him from the dead. And dead, God, did you hear me? And from a dead man's bones, he fulfilled that 14th miracle and brought to pass what God said through that man of God, Elijah. If you're here and see me, I came by to tell somebody, this ain't a time to give up. It ain't a time to quit. If you understand prophetic word from the Bible, we're in the last days, and the Bible said that the enemy is going to try to shake everything that can be shaken so that the things that cannot be shaken will remain. You've got to endure it to the end. This ain't a time to lay down. It ain't a time to quit. I've made it up in my mind that my future's brighter than what my past has been. Tomorrow I'm going to fulfill the will of God for my life. God's got a plan.
Amen.
You might see me struggling right now, but God's got a plan.
Come on. Come on.
He's got a plan.
Yes.
Could I go a step further?
Come on.
I'm sitting on my couch and this hit me today, and I dreamt up, glory to God. See, I shout at my house every now and then. I've never seen this in Scripture before. I'm reading that 2 Kings chapter 2. God said to me today, I have given the church Elijah's mantle, but I have not yet given them the double portion.
Come on.
And I thought, what are you talking about? He said, I gave them a down payment on the day of Pentecost, an earnest of the Spirit on the day of Pentecost. But what I'm about to do with the last day church, my God. He said before the coming of the Lord, there'll be a latter rain and a former rain. He said, I gave them the former rain from the prophecy of Joel chapter 2, that upon my handmaids and maidservants will I pour out of my spirit. But the church has not yet seen the double portion. They're living off of Pentecost that happened 2,000 years ago. mantle, but I haven't yet given that double portion. And it's going to come right before the rapture. And the catch of the way. See, some of us, I know what it's like to be hurt. I know what it's like to have a child that's not in church with you. I know what it's like. I feel prophetic words coming. I've seen years of Ivy and Ronnie crying over their children. They get in, get out, get in, get out, get in, get out. But I heard the Lord speak to me today and say, I don't care how strung out they get. I don't care how far they get out. Ronnie and Ivy, there's coming a day, all of them, seven of them coming in this church. Did you hear what I said? I said, there's coming a day God's going to turn this thing around. When we get done with the shaking, there may be a few of us left, but whoever's left, God's going to drop a mantle on us with a double portion, and those kids are coming in here. I'm going to prophesy right now. I don't think we're the best that has happened yet. I believe the best is yet to come. And can I make this statement right quick? Right early, right quick, says the Lord. I'm going to come. You've been through the storm. You've been through Jericho. You've been through the battle. You've prayed until you're sick of praying. But I hear the word of the Lord tonight that in a few days, the Holy Ghost is going to fall like a double portion of this church.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
I don't know about you. I ask God, why didn't you let me preach this on Sunday morning when all of us are here? And I heard the Lord very plainly say, because all of them won't get that double portion. I'm only interested in the ones that's going to tarry and follow the man of God. I'm not talking about me. I'm talking about following the things of God until you get what your heart's desire is. I believe God's raising up young people in this church.
Amen.
I believe God's raising up young people and laying His hand on young men to sing with a passion like we don't know because we let it go. When He talks about it, He's a pain. If you got pain, He's a pain taker. Do you hear me? I'm telling you, God's raising them up. How dare we shut them off? No, sir. I'm telling you, the Bible said in that last day, the church is going to be led by earth children. Why? Because Joel promised that her sons and daughters are going to prophesy. Yeah, Lord. Sons and daughters. Going to prophesy. I don't know how much you want from God tonight. Y'all come on to the music. Get something up and go on. Let's get it. I don't know how much you want from God. And you may be satisfied with where you're at. But I'm going to tell you, here's a preacher that's not. I'm tired of the battle of my mind. I'm tired of the battle of my flesh. I'm tired of the battle that I'm going through. The only way that I'm going to endure it and carry it out is to get more of the Holy Ghost living in me. You know, of course, I tell you. I feel like having an old-fashioned prayer line tonight. Can we do that? Lord God, the weight of the Lord is on me. My gosh. Help me out. Randy Moley, give me a bottle of oil. I want something good. What key are you in right there? Go to A. One of you girls can pick up the lead on this. If you want to be touched by God, come on, get in the line up here. Well, Jesus on that main line, tell him what you want. Jesus on that main line, tell him what you want. Jesus on that main line, tell him what you want. Jesus on that main line, tell him call him up, tell him what you want. Call him up, tell him what you want. Call him up, tell him what you want. Jesus on that main line.
Thank you.
God's made. You know, I can't wait to just to tell somebody and talk to people about my Lord. Gosh, that's important. That's important in their lives. Amen. Praise the Lord. Does anybody have anything to say? Want to testify or anything?
Praise God. Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord. Somebody's neck on the way out.